are incredibly important. You can see I don't have the capacity to go to each one of you every day and make sure that you've started this correct. So the only thing I can do is offer guidance and make suggestions for this is when you need to stop this, this is when you need to stop this. And then when we have specific dates for deliverables, like a picture or a poster, my assumption is you started a particular task on the day. So by this date, you should be able to present it in one or two. Am I making sense? My only role is to prepare you for a very tough end of the year exam. I have no other agendas. So you must forgive me if I sometimes appear a little bit quite strict with deliverables or dates or expectations of studio attendance. My only intention with that is to prepare you. When I joined end of last year, there was a little bit of a mix-up regards the coordination of the final year studio. And it left the students in a situation where their books were not exam ready. Now, I think it's a date in September when your supervisor has to sign or approve the book for examination. I've also been checking the regulations very carefully the last few days. Checking the regulations very carefully, and there was a lot of stuff we did last year that really was not acceptable according to the university regulations. We had a trick meeting, was it last week, and Prof. Munda from the Dean's Office attended that meeting with us with all of the regulations. So as an example, people last year had just sent an email saying they have decided to continue next year. I found that by regulations, they should have just gotten a zero in the exam. By regulations, we should have just said this person was not in attendance and therefore it's a 0%. And Prof. Munda said, if you had done that, the faculty would have supported you. That was the right procedure to do. So the only reason I'm saying this is to alert everyone. There will be no easy option to continue this in 2019. Yes, the regulations say you can do it over several years, but there have to be very valid reasons. The project has to be approved, and there's a set system now for being able to do that continuation. Okay. So if I put deadlines for you now for 2018, so that you can complete by November our set exam dates, it is really to protect you. So I really need your support in this process. If the schedule says conceptual design, or there's an expectation that you've done site analysis, just make sure you've done it. If you haven't done it, the only thing I'm being relatively strict about, I'm not even that strict, is studio attendance 3 hours over 3 days a week. Okay? Some of you are taking it very seriously. I notice. I really appreciate that. I notice who's there consistently. If someone is there not there for a day or two, I don't take it too seriously because the person is generally there, so it's fine. Those of you that are not taking it seriously, I also notice that, so, and it was really not to your own benefit. That's my only concern. It's not a policing thing, it's just not benefiting you. There's 3 hours, 3 days a week. It just kind of gets us to interact, gets me to walk around feeling what's happening. But if you feel, and this is a request again for your own benefit, are not really up to the expected stage that is in that year calendar, please be there 5 days a week full time. And if there's a need, I'll come extra hours and I'll pass by and I'll assist you. If you drop me a note, I'll come. But if you are noticing you are really not, you haven't really done the full site analysis, you haven't started the conceptual design, your proposal is still not up to the expected standard, please just up those hours significantly, catch up, and then you can relax again. Does that make sense to you? I'm only trying to get you to that completion and to avoid the complexities of ending up in a situation where the faculty is no longer allowing us to easily take the topic from year to year or for that continuation. There's much stringent procedures in place this year, and the faculty is very alert to that. Okay. So I've worked on these proposals. You'll probably find that I have a very particular way of where's your need. Design project at the end is only it's only assessed by external exams. So you understand our stress in trying to prepare. You have nothing to do with the marks. You send it out there, you put up your work, and an external panel comes to assess, and in a way, they are also assessing our performance as lecturers. So when we give you marks for your projects, like in the Petra Kutcha, it is only to alert you to where we think you're at. It actually counts for nothing. But I think it's useful for you to know it. Am I right? I think it's useful for you to know what a panel of assessors think of your project at that particular stage. And trust me, the externals are much tougher than we are. They're much tougher. So, please use all of this information in such a way as to manage your own process and develop your own project. So the proposals, as I said, my expectation is you've already worked on them, which is great. Take the rest of the comments, fix it up. Every document that I have given out with my notes in pencil and my mark must be returned to me with the final submission. I will check that things have been addressed and I will amend, hopefully, in all cases, amend the mark accordingly. Okay. So it's only if you're really, really careless that the mark will. But as it stands, there's a lot that are really not there. There's like gaps and things are incomplete. And the thing I focused on and that you'll see is I tried to extract what are the key points? What are you trying to say? Or what's this project? What are the intentions and what are the expected outcomes? And in quite a few of the documents, you'll see I listed A, B, C, or 1, 2, 3. And then I assessed the whole document based on that 1, 2, 3. So if you say there's an urban regeneration element to the project, there's a social intention, and there's an architecture that intends to reflect X, Y, and Z. I have used your own criteria, which I extracted from your text. I've listed that, and I've then gone through the document based on that list of three or four criteria. And I strongly advise, don't try to be too clever with the writing. A few of you speak really clearly about the project and its intentions, and then the writing is kind of convoluted and complicated, and the key information or key points are lost in a lot of unnecessary text. That's quite a few of you did that. Some of you write more and quite intelligently, but still the message seems to become very vague. You can't find it. So extract from your own text. If my assessment was right in terms of what points 1, 2, 3, 4 are, if I'm right, then keep that and structure your whole book, including your chapters and sections accordingly. Your problem statement, your hypothesis, base everything, your literature survey, base it on points 1, 2, 3, 4. If I'm wrong, it's your project, just fix it. Rewrite the three or four points and then structure your document. So any note I have written is a mere suggestion, advice. It's not a prescription. It's just intended to tell you, I'm looking for your key purpose, intention, expected output. And if I miscaptured it, just fix it and structure your document accordingly. Am I making sense? Okay, so that's just the thing. I have not done any thorough editing. If I've noticed that you don't write too well, or the sentences are cut off, or they're not making sense, I just alert you. I don't think it's my job to do the editing for you. You can excuse. exchange it among ourselves, we can give it to a family, a friend, or later on in the year. Strongly advise, and I hope you advise, and I hope you've put it into your budget, you need to send it for language editing. But just try to get it to a state, especially for the research methodology module. Get it to an acceptable stage. Sometimes there are just sentences that don't make sense. Generally, it is not very, very bad. It's not bad in terms of editing, but definitely in a few cases, some of you are better writers than others, and it shows. So if you know you're not a great writer, just give it to someone else to help you scan over it. Everything clear around process, research, methodology, marking, everything is clear. Excellent. So I'm just going to go through this presentation, which looks at the design process. To a few of you in the studio, identify who you are as a designer. That's another thing that you need to be very clever with in this final year. Each one of you has strengths and weaknesses. You know what your strengths are. Let's use that and work accordingly, because it's almost too late in the process to change who you are, but who you are as a designer could possibly really be unique, interesting, if presented or pitched in a particular way. Okay, so what is design activity? Is design a creative activity that takes place in the mind of the designer only to be seen as a final product, or is it an activity that can be explained by the designer? Is it a systematic process? And we're actually asking you to explain a lot in this year. We're asking you to really tell us what you're about, what's your position, what's your project about, how are you going to develop the design. We're asking you to explain. Now, these questions ask, is it possible? Are there parts of the process where it's just not possible to explain? How do you deal with that in this process? Is the designer a glass box or a black box? Have you come across this expression before? Is the designer a glass box? So you can actually understand where all the design decisions come from. You can motivate, explain, I decided to do this because of X, Y, and Z. It's clear and it's easy to communicate. Or does the designer operate as a black box and just present the product and say, this is it, with no explanations? Do you think the designer is a black box or a glass box?
Glass box.
Who said glass? Glass box. Do you really believe that?
I think the designer should be a glass box.
Should be. It allows for participation.
Yes, and if they understand, if you take for instance with client and designer relationship, if you just deliver a product and they don't understand it, it's more likely for them to let go of the project and want a new idea for them. When you take it through the process, they'll understand why things look the way it looks or acts the way it looks, so it's easy for the client to also understand the product instead of you just giving the product and then it's, I don't like it. But if they have an understanding of why it is what it is, yeah, so that's.
Does everyone agree with Kyle as the designer of glass box?
I think as designer, one should actually, I'm the opposite of Kyle, where I should actually say that you give the design to the client who's not knowledge in that sense, who doesn't know that what his requirements actually are. So you present it to him and you tell him, well, this is basically what you require. This is what you need to progress maybe in a business or whatever. So I'd say give him the product and that's what he will work in, and that's how he can actually flourish with the business.
but can you explain from a product, can you say, I made these design decisions because?
Definitely there should be influence to the design based on the maybe the current situation of the client or the business.
So it can be explained. Just trying to understand.
Yeah.
It can be explained. Yes.
I think the designer should be capable of seeing as perfectly. So designers are glass boxes. Someone who is knowledgeable about design as well, can understand your influences, but then if you approach a client who sees you as design as a black box and is able to distill everything you've done as a design as a glass box, you find that it is it to you so that the worker so that they can accept this what it is.
I would say it depends on the client, because if you design a home for a person, you need to be a glass box, transparent, and talk and interact with the client, do something beautiful. But if it's more of a corporate thing you're designing, they only, most of them only care about the bottom line. So they care less about the influence and interactivity, but more on the final product at the end of the day. So it basically depends on the client what you're designing for.
Yes, last one.
Can
you explain the drugs and how show what you've done? So, I had the experience that I was in my office and I had to design stitches of our house. And it was as simple as with the garden space I drew, my hand was too dark. And the client rejected the whole scheme because he thought that my space would be dark just because of the way that I presented it. And yeah, so The question here is, can you explain why you put the garden there, why it's shaped in that way, and why? Best answer, I think, is from Michael. The designer is both a black box and a glass box. I really appreciate what Kyle is saying, and if you have a client, you need to be able to explain to them decisions. But the reality is there are certain parts of the process that are impossible to explain. Yeah, and architects are really good at post-rationalizing. Just because of the way our education system works, you know, you put it up and then you start using this kind of descriptive stuff, and I did this because of that. But not every design and spatial decision we make can be fully transparent and explained. We need to accept that in the design process, you operate both as a glass box. It needs to be democratic, cooperative, collaborative. You need to share information with others. You need to include others in the decision making. But there's certain parts of it that might not be as easy to explain. Okay, how do you use Twitter and Facebook? I started using the hashtags #TUTArc6 and #TUT6. I also use TUT Carabololo, TUT Building 11, TUT Architecture. Anyone picking up any material I'm sharing on Twitter or Facebook? A few of you, but. And please also, if you find anything related to what I'm discussing now or discussions we're having in studio, you can also share and tag us and use those hashtags so we can find it. But I've shared quite a few things, not a lot yet, but quite a few things on Facebook and Twitter that I would very much like you to see. So this is someone on Twitter saying, design is both artistic and scientific. It's a hybrid discipline with the accent on hybrid. Twitter and Facebook are really good educational tools. Just stop following your sister or brother, or unfriend your mother, and then you'll find the beneficial people on Facebook and Twitter. us through the looking glass. Now for the evidence, said the king, and then the sentence. No, said the queen. First the sentence, and then the evidence. Nonsense, cried Alice, so loudly that everybody jumped. The idea of having the sentence first. Architects are really good at post-fashion analysis. So we kind of do the design, and then we try and explain how we arrived at the design. Now, if we are very conscious of our brain operating as both in a glass box and black box mode, we would be better able to manage that process, including the parts that are very accessible, easy, or possible to explain. Nothing is easy about design. And then the parts that are more creative, intuitive. I've also asked quite a few of you in studio about whether you operate in a systematic manner or a more intuitive manner. And I say it with absolutely no judgment. You can be intuitive and you can be systematic. As long as you know your particular work method and you really understand and use it well. So these are some of the books that I've used over the years as resources to try and understand my own design process, but also to try and explain to students what the design process is and get them to really understand their own design process. Other architects, other designers that work in a manner similar to yours so that you can benefit. Designers work in very diverse ways. So this is 100 contemporary architects. How designers think. Do you know any of these books? Very useful books. This one is the subtitle. There is the design process demystified. And I really believe if you want to teach something, you have to be able to explain it, even if it has parts of it. Like when you operate as a black box, even if there's a part of it that's very intuitive, creative, difficult to explain, you still need to be aware that there's certain parts of it. And if one looks at the design process, I mean, we're asking you for this proposal now and in studio to analyze your site, to present your problem, to give us a hypothesis. So we're really asking you to operate as glass boxes and to unpack all of your decision-making and rationale and motivations. We're deliberately asking you that. But I'm fully aware that at some stage there's going to be a much more creative process happening. I was hoping it started last Monday. So you're going to help me, whoever hasn't started, to start immediately. So you take all that data, you take all that material, all of that analysis you've done, and then you start to do something creative with it. Okay. There are always different solutions to the design process, and that's why it's not always 100% systematic. Now in this particular example, there's this building, site analysis, where the noise is coming from, where you get the good views, where the sun directions are. And then someone else looks at the same problem, looking at where the entrances are, looking at particular nodes within the design. And someone else does something completely different and starts off by looking at the structural grid and developing a structure within which you can start putting different functions and responding to different site conditions. Now, these are three attempts, initial attempts, at the same design problem. Are any of them right or wrong? So you just need to figure out who you are as a designer and how you go around this design process. It's difficult to decide whether any of these approaches are better than the others, and it is certainly not possible to declare entry either right or wrong. Although at first sight these three approaches may seem different, in fact they share basically the same overall strategy. In each case, a a group of sub-elements of the overall problem, sub-elements of the overall problem have been clustered together and elevated to form, or to the role of form generator. Now, I want you to start thinking of the proposal and the way you're going to steer your problems as something that will ultimately help you achieve some resolution spatially, architecturally, in terms of form making, in terms of material selection. And if you formulate your questions in that way now, it's easier to achieve that as you go along. The most important thing about your research project proposal is that it has to be doable within the set time frames. So if you go and revisit your proposals now after this session, you see this is like really vague or vaguely presented, and it's not very clear how it's translating into my architectural project. Rewrite your problem. Okay, make it easy for yourself. Just rewrite it. What differentiates the three approaches is simply the kind of constraint which has been used in this focal role. The first and last group concentrated on the way the building should be organized by focusing on internal constraints, while the second group looked at the external constraints imposed by the cycle. Okay, again, sketches, and some of you seem to be very reluctant. At least one of you said, I'm not really good with sketching. My comment was, have you ever seen the Corbusier sketches? There's nothing beautiful about that. So, you know, just start drawing. Just start sketching. And the important thing is to develop your own strategy. Find the architects and the designers that work like you and work with them. Okay, so these are just different sketches looking at the junction between wall and ceiling. Other sketches looking at alternatives for buildings on site. I'm not yet seeing that. I'm really hoping after this lecture to come into the studio and start seeing these kind of investigations. A few of you have put some initial design ideas into the proposal document, and I appreciate it. But it doesn't have to be very long, but just the initial kind of start. So I appreciate it very much. Okay, but I'm not seeing that iterative process yet, and I'm hoping to see it very soon. For those of you that are not there yet, panicking is not what I'm aiming for. I'm encouraging you to get started, but this is also it needs to be a somewhat relaxed process of exploration. If you leave it for another week or two, then we will go into pattern. Okay, so just do me a favor by starting now, so that you just have that luxury, if I can call it that, of in a relaxed manner exploring your site, exploring your problem, exploring your spaces. I strongly advise you, and like I said, I can only advise, I can't enforce this. Only advice, do not leave this in the process. Okay, we need to start seeing these options. So where do you get your inspiration from? Maybe in a second. Where do you get your inspiration from? Now we've spoken about the very practical, systematic, easy to explain parts of the process, and we will continue to do it in the proposal documents and as you draft your books. But there's also things that inspire you, that trigger interesting ideas. And usually, if you study, if you research the creative process, and I advise that you do, you'll find that you do need to do a lot of preparation. And once you've done enough preparation, interesting ideas start to emerge in your mind. I also believe that I had motivation through drawing, through model building, so I'm enjoying the exploration that Ruan is doing in Alodi, presenting the site in different ways, and analysing parts of it, analysing it as an urban context. I have no idea where he's going, and I don't think he knows either. But I also feel that when you do that very rigorous, thorough process, something will emerge. A pattern will emerge. So ultimately, he himself will start seeing meaning in this, and ourselves as instructors will also be able to advise once that rigorous analysis is in place. So that's one way of being inspired, is going through representing your site in 20 different ways, looking at different focus aspects in each drawing or doing a range of models. You have to do that, even if you don't know what the design looks like or how you're going to go about it. You need to do that rigorous analysis, and our ideas will come from that. So I've made my suggestions for how inspiration can happen. Anyone else have advice for us in terms of where inspiration can come from?
Bad colleagues. As you analyze, you see a bad colleague of your wall first place, only then do think what I can break down. I think that starts a conversation, it starts a process. So it's not always looking at good colleagues as pieces. I've actually done it with a bad colleagues as pieces. Not to do so. I think it's a good starting point. Obviously, it's a good starting point if you want to do a good building. But I think if you already start at a point where you can build out what is wrong and how not to do it. For instance, the housing that I'm doing is looking at different examples of the social aspects of housing and how it's not working in South Africa.
Then that starts helping you generate ideas. That's like, what's that program? Not to wear? So, what not to decide, or how not to decide. There's always a kind of a sense of outrage at poorly designed spaces and buildings that might trigger a response in an alternative way. Do any of you particular work approaches to kickstart that?
Mine specifically is to talk about my work. So if I talk to anybody, and sometimes I'm just talking to myself, if I can hear out loud what I'm doing as I'm talking, it's developing, and then I will start sketching from my talk. From my hand, I've noticed. I need to verbally hear myself say the words in a project, and then I'll start criticizing myself and sketching it out and like discussing my project with myself. It's a very weird process, but
do you sketch as we're doing?
Yeah, so I'll start off with, for instance, I'll start discussing the project to myself, and then I'll explain the project to myself and say, "Yeah, but you want to do this," and then I'll start sketching, and then I generally have two different colors. So the one person had to speak to the other one and sound very stupid. And that's I kind of criticize my own work as well. So I play devil's advocate on my own.
I really appreciate what you're saying. So I've noticed Kyle speaks much better than he writes. So he has these wonderful ideas. So it's actually not a bad idea at all. I've asked him to rewrite sections of the proposal in exactly the way he describes it. So that's the self-reflection that we need. And if you have a particular strength, you need to figure out how to use it. So when Carl explains that this is what I'm doing, and that's the purpose of it, and these are the different arguments around it, it makes absolute sense. When one reads it, it starts getting a little bit, the message gets lost. So even reading through some of your proposals, I actually, I get really stuck, I will read a section out loud. So it's not as crazy as you think, Kyle. When I read it out loud, it falls into place, or otherwise it's confirmed this is not making sense. But I give it the, I try and give that text a chance by reading sections of it. So sometimes the inspiration can come from the unexpected, so I'll just put some images here. Why don't we start doing something that might appear ridiculous, but ultimately might lead us somewhere? Again, similar to Ruan's very rigorous and thorough analysis, maybe we need to, before we have all the information, now that's a tricky thing. If you're the kind of person who is so systematic that you're delaying making design decisions until you have all the information, that's very problematic, because you probably will never have all the information. There's an author that says an adaptive process is the most intelligent because you're constantly working with the latest available information. So you need to start making some desired decisions now with the information that you have. Okay? And as you get more information, you're adapting and you're changing. But that's also why we very deliberately immerse you in this very systematic, transparent glass box process early on in the process, so that you collect as much data as you can. At the bigger picture, I said, I think at least one of your colleagues, do not put yourself in a situation where the panel, as soon as it sits there, there's a glaring, controversial issue and it's shot down immediately. And completely, the whole process, you kind of doomed. And that's why this very rigorous process initially to draft these proposals, to avoid at least all of the major questions, major issues having been answered. But then there's a lot of other finer detail that will only emerge as you proceed. And sometimes the ridiculous or the unexpected, if you test it out, might ultimately generate something. Things like playing with scale, just changing the scale or the particular location. So that's what I use Twitter for, to look for things like that. I really hope you start seeing you sharing stuff on Facebook. So what are the design tools and generators? What are the design tools and tools that we use to generate design? Yes.
Like the science that are outside, you know, experiencing that all the way.
Seeing the site at different times of the day, places. Explaining all of that in your proposals. I'm hoping it will emerge in your books. Just that relationship to site and users and seeing things. A lot of you kind of look at your site from a very bird's eye view, and you're not really zooming in and seeing who's walking across here every day, who's sitting in corners. I'm not seeing enough of that, so I'm hoping I'll start seeing that. But model building, drawing, site visits, definitely those are your tools. And then once you're on site, there are various tools that you use for observation, for documentation. Okay, what else? Is there like one tool you favor above all others and why?
Also look at the fabric and the textures on site, and that can also influence the way you start developing.
Materiality, yeah. Texture. textures, colors.
Speak to each other, and that's the purpose of this brief presentation.
going to be inspired by what I've seen as speaking this week. I will be sending out a few more instructions regarding the posters and the picture. Remember that assumption is that you are doing the work, so if I ask you to compile it in a particular way, I assume you're doing it. So don't waste time. You need to be working on the design and the